Hello everyone, welcome back to the Home Lab. A question I get asked a lot is what hardware should I use to build my server? Usually that follows on with, I want to do things like storage, I want to do things like Home Assistant, I want to run Proxmox, I want to run OpenSense. And the answer really is, I don't know. I can give informed guesses, but it really depends on what your skill set is and what you want to learn. So here in front of me, I have three things that I use regularly. I have my box computer, my HP microserver, and a thin client. This is not an actual thin client that I use regularly, but I have more of them. I have a ton of these. So these represent the three tiers of price and performance that I have shown on my channel in the past. On one hand, we have a computer you build yourself. In my case, I chose to eliminate the case and save money. Now that means all my parts are hanging out all over the place. So if I want to use spinning hard drives or something like that, they're going to be kind of stacked up and it's going to be kind of ugly. Maybe I could 3D print something, but it's work, you know. Next up, we have buying used servers. This HP microserver is a used server. At one point, it was relatively expensive and it was good at what it did. And now it has been retired and given on to me. You can usually find these online relatively cheaply. The downside is, while they're quite powerful, they're also quite old and draw a lot of power. And in some cases, upgradability might be a problem because while this can fit standard PCI cards, some of them might use non-standard brackets or risers, non-standard cables, all kinds of weird quirks like that. And last up, my favorite little thin client buddies. These things have awful processors, but they get the job done if you're comparing to like a Raspberry Pi. So for the absolute budget home labbers, I've used these. For the tinkerers, building yourself is probably the option. And if you really want to get into enterprise-like equipment, buying used is never a bad deal. But today I want to explore another option. I got a box. So in this box, we will find a brand new NAS. You can buy these on the internet for a few hundred bucks. They'll fit a few 3.5-inch drives. They might fit an SSD or an NVMe or something like that. And a lot of them will run either an ARM or an x86 processor. So I went out and I looked for one of the cheapest ones I could find with an x86 processor so I can run relatively standard software without fighting with the ARM Linux distributions. And I came to this guy. It's made by Terramaster. Now, they did send it to me, but they didn't actually send me the one I asked for. They sent me one with two cores instead of four. So it's going to be at a little bit of a disadvantage in terms of performance. So let's see what we got in the box. It's exactly how it came to me. I have not opened it yet. I got another box. And I got the unit. Super tiny. So this thing retails for 300 bucks as the time I made this video. It is basically the lowest end model that Terramaster makes from their most recent series that uses an x86 processor. So it is the F2-223. If it was the 423, then it would have a quad core and I would be happier, but it is the 223. Being their new model, it has 2.5 gig Ethernet in the back. So we got dual 2.5 gig HDMI, 12 volt power brick and two USB 3s, and that is all we have for connectivity here. So I'm hoping we can install some regular operating systems on this, and we're going to try that out. But first, what do we get in the little box? Teeny tiny little wall brick. It's a good sign of things to come if this is how much power it's going to use, because the microserver draws a lot. Okay, 12 volt 4 amps, so this could do 48 watts if it was loading up the brick as high as the brick can go. That's pretty good, honestly, because the hard drives are going to draw like 10 watts each. The whole system is only going to draw like 10 more. That's not bad. They got some stickers to label your hard drives. I would be absolutely terrified if I saw someone's house, they had a stack of bare hard drives labeled with what was on them. Please don't do that. But if you really want to, stickers. So it looks like it's tool lists for 3.5-inch drives, but you need screws for a 2.5-inch drive, which I guess makes sense because the caddy isn't sized for 2.5-inch drives. And a quick install guide. It's literally just a QR code. Okay, so that's everything we need. Now let's take it apart and see what's inside. Got the iFixit toolkit just in case. Once again, not sponsored, but I love iFixit. They make good stuff. Okay, so we got four screws in the back. That might be it. Phillips. Not Phillips. I can't even... No, I think it's number two Phillips. Yeah, number two. Oh, wow, these are tight. Holy shit. So in theory, there's supposed to be some SSD storage inside. I don't remember if it was SATA or NVMe. And look super closely. Oh, wow. These are tight. Get out of there. There we go. Let's see what happens. Okay, it came out. And there's a fan header. A flat blade to take out the fan header. Or just leave it dangling. This is not a standard fan header at all. So let's see what we got inside. Just taking a look down inside, we got what appears to be a motherboard here. This appears to be a PCIe slot, although I'm not sure if they're just using that as a riser card connector. And this daughter board has the two SATA connectors. Let's see if we can pull the whole thing out. Oh, so the whole thing goes out the bottom. Oh, that's a interesting design choice. Yeah, I guess it makes sense. Okay, so looking at this thing, we've got an M.2 here that looks like a 2280, and that's also 2280. There are markings on the board for a 2260 and a 2242, but there aren't standoff locations there. They're not drilled. So it looks like 2280 is the only length for M.2. It does not say if it is SATA or NVMe. Guess I'll have to try both. I got one RAM stick back here that's empty. And there's another RAM stick in here that's a 4 gig sodimm, DDR4, 2400 megahertz. So a little tiny USB drive in here. I'm wondering if that's what it boots from. So because 4 gigs is kind of awful, I bought some more, and I'm going to put 8 gigs in. So I bought two 8 gig sticks. I could put 8 gig here and 8 gig there, but this one looks like kind of a pain. So I'm just going to put one 8 gig stick in, and we'll have 12 gigs of RAM. 12 gigs will be perfectly fine for what we're going to do with this. Home Assistant doesn't need a ton. OpenSense doesn't need a ton. Plus, you're always free to go big if you want. This is a 8 gig DDR4 3200. A little bit excessive for this guy, but that's fine. And I don't know which SSD slot I like better, so we'll use... I need a smaller Phillips. Do a number 0, and I'm going to use this slot. No idea if it matters or not. The drive I have is a Samsung 960 Evo, which is NVMe. If this does not work, I have a SATA drive I can try putting in. But we'll try NVMe first. So if you're using ZFS, this NVMe drive will be a great application for the ZFS special device. Or you could use a separate ZFS pool on the NVMe versus the spinning Rust, however you like. Depends on what you're using for software. If you want to use true NAS, you're probably going to have to reprogram the little tiny USB stick, or you'll have to dedicate one of your M.2 slots to the boot drive, because true NAS aggressively refuses to let people use their boot pool for other things. If you're using Proxmox, you can of course boot from the NVMe and also use it for other things, which is what I'm going to do. So let's put this little guy back together. Just kind of slides in there. For storage, I have a pair of 2 terabyte WD Reds. They're not very significant, but they're two out of the microserver. So the microserver and this will basically have the same drives in it. Let's see how this toolless thing works. There are instructions for it. I didn't read them. So I need to pry this. Oh, yeah, that was easy. That just comes right off. So the drive should just sit in here. And these little fingers should... hold it in. Yeah, that one went in. Yeah, that felt like a big clunk. Undo the next one. Gotta line up little pegs to go on little holes. There are even like little rubber vibration isolators here, which is, I guess, better than I was expecting. Let's get in there. Okay, we're in. So this guy's set up. We got a 500 gig NVMe, two terabyte spinning Rust. Let's power on and see what we get. So I got it plugged in to the monitor. Monitor is on. Keyboard is plugged in. Ethernet is not plugged in because I'm going to log and see what it tries to connect to. Let's plug in the power. I got a kilowatt meter there so we can record how much power it uses. Looks like it's powering on automatically. Power light came on. Both hard drive lights came on. LAN did not come on. That's what we expected. We get anything on HDMI? AMI. Press Dell to enter setup. Type Jasper Lake Celeron N4505. You're free to look that up in Intel Arc. It's not a terrible processor. It's pretty darn modern. It correctly detected our 12 gigs of RAM. Boot option, hard disk, UEFI, USB disk, NVMe, CD-DVD, SD network. So I click boot option one. So my options are hard disk, USB device, that's probably the internal USB device, NVMe, CD-DVD network disabled. So we'll leave that on hard disk. So it defaults to booting from hard disk, which is interesting. I wonder if they wouldn't put the OS on the hard disk. Maybe they would. So it's detected by Samsung 960 Evo. That's a good sign. I honestly don't know if the NVMe slot supports SATA as well, but it supports NVMe. So let's see where it boots us. I've done nothing except plug in these drives. These drives have stuff on them, but not an operating system. Booting from init system, booting form init system. It runs some kind of Linux. It's beeping. So I'm getting a bunch of error messages here that it's sending discover, DHCP discover is not getting anything. This looks like it's configured for DHCP by default and I didn't plug it in. So that's something. So I have connected this to a dedicated interface on my firewall. I am going to plug it into one of the ports in the back randomly. Not sure which one it is. Okay, got a message, ETH0, NIC link is up. So .6 was my computer when I was testing to make sure that it all worked. .7 is the new one, and DHCP is stripped out before the log. So it looks like it tried to connect to multicast group, and I believe that is MDNS. Yeah, so this is MDNS. So it's advertising itself on MDNS, which honestly makes sense. So let's try to connect to its web interface. 100.69.96.7. Loading the bootloader from server. Please wait. Well, that's an interesting thing. So it's gone out to the internet and connected to wherever these servers are. No idea what it's doing now. Loading the bootloader from server. Only one LAN port can be connected during initialization. Please keep your TNAS device connected to the internet. Otherwise, you cannot install TOS online. You will need to download TOS installation package, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so only one LAN port is connected. Do you want to initialize your TNAS? Custom. Okay, so I think what's happening here is this does not have an operating system disk on it. It just has the bootloader, which is going off to the internet, and it wants to install its operating system on one of my drives. So how badly do we want to see TOS, their operating system? I don't really. Let's boot Proxmox and see what that looks like. So Proxmox installed on the NVMe drive, and it won't boot. Keeps coming up into the USB disk that can't find its operating system. Okay, I got it booting off the NVMe drive. I had to go into the BIOS and change the NVMe settings to select the preferred drive. It was defaulting to disabled. So once I went in there and told it that the preferred NVMe drive was the one that is installed, it booted to it just fine. And here we are. Welcome to Proxmox Virtual Environment. So for some reason, this keeps booting up to that internal USB disk, even if I set the priority differently. So I'm going to pull that USB disk out, see if that helps things. Here's a teeny tiny little drive that has probably been causing me problems. We have two internal USB headers that look like standard front USB. So let's see if putting it back together without its little boot disk makes it rethink its life choices and boot from the NVMe drive like I want it to. Why don't we try from a cold boot? When it has no other options, it's forced to boot from something that's not the USB disk. What is it gonna do? There we go, booting into Proxmox. So pulling this little USB drive out was the problem. So coming on into Proxmox here, we have our local ZFS system. This is the NVMe drive. So I click on this, we'll see 480 gigs. It's my 500 gig NVMe drive, same with storage. So now I've got to add a ZFS pool on the spinning disks. So I'm gonna click on the node, go down to ZFS, create. So we found two disks here, SDA, SDB. So the first pool is called R pool. So I guess we'll call this one D pool for data. And we are going to set read level to mirror. Order doesn't really matter here. So we're going to automatically add storage. Compression is on, A shift is 12. Let us create. So So another important metric is power consumption. So Proxmox is just idling here, and we are drawing about 15 watts. That is not bad. Now, we're not running any VMs or anything, but that's pretty low. Let's see what the microserver can do. So I got the same setup with the microserver. Microserver has two spinning hard drives and one SATA SSD, whereas that one had NVMe. And it is currently drawing about 40 watts. It's flickering, so 42, 38, so 40 watts. So this thing uses less than half the power idling. This thing is currently doing nothing except running the disks. So what did I think of the Terramaster F2-223? Well, this little brick is definitely a reasonable choice if you want a low-cost home server. Two and a half gig Ethernet ports, that means we can do some fun high-speed routing, or you can just do high-speed storage if you're into that. Two spinning drive bays, two NVMe bays, and I got it to boot Proxmox, so you shouldn't have any problems booting TrueNAS either. I didn't do that, of course. Power consumption is pretty darn low, which I'm happy about because I spend way too much powering this little brick here and all my other servers. So to give you an idea of pricing, it's currently December of 2022, and this little thing is selling for $300. The quad-core version of the same thing, so just an upgraded CPU, is $380. The 4-bay version, still with a 2-core CPU, is $440. The 4-bay with quad-core is $500. And the same thing in a rack mount chassis is $700. So prices go up, but if you're looking at something like a Synology or a QNAP, but you want to run the software yourself and don't want to pay for their software for this is not great. So don't feel bad about reformatting it. Once I figured out that this little USB key was making my life miserable, I got Proxmox booting pretty easily. So this is going to become a new tutorial of mine, the Proxmox all-in-one home server. So if you'd like to see me build an all-in-one home server featuring Home Assistant, OpenSense, everything that people love to run in their home, on this little tiny little box here, I will do some more detailed benchmarking once I get some applications running on it. So don't forget to like and subscribe. When you subscribe, you get to follow along in this series of mine. I have a Discord channel down below if you'd like to follow me or chat with me more there. And as always, I'll see you on the next adventure.